My name is Marianne Peters, and for those who don't know me, I'm the CEO of the Carter Center. It's my pleasure, I think this is a little high, to welcome you to the first conversation at the Carter Center of the 2016-2017 season. This series gives us an opportunity to discuss Carter Center peace and health efforts and current world affairs issues with our friends in the Atlanta area, and sometimes with friends from far beyond the Atlanta area. And I'm very pleased to welcome here tonight not only our mental health journalism fellows, some of whom are in attendance, but also our Embassy and Legacy Circle members and any members of our Board of Trustees or Board of Counselors who are here this evening. We're very happy that you traveled to be with us, and of course we're always happy to have our fellow Atlantans here. Tonight's conversation is a very special one, as we'll get to hear it from President and Mrs. Carter, the Carter Center's founders, in a town hall format. If you have a question for either President Carter or Mrs. Carter, please write it down on the index cards we have thoughtfully provided. Volunteers will walk down the aisles to collect your questions during the first half of the event. Before we start, though, I'd like to remind you, please silence your cell phones. I know you'd rather not hear your unique ring while either President or Mrs. Carter is speaking. President and Mrs. Carter founded the Carter Center 34 years ago, and since then, the Carter Center's programs have helped to improve life for people in more than 80 countries. The center's staff wage peace, fight disease, and build hope, both by engaging with those at the highest levels of government and by working side by side with poor and neglected people, often literally at the end of the road. President and Mrs. Carter are the center's hardest working volunteers and are integrally engaged in our work. They've traveled the world monitoring elections and resolving conflicts, promoting human rights, helping to eradicate disease in developing nations, and to erase the stigma of mental illness both here in Georgia and in Africa. It is their vision for a world at peace that guides our work at the Carter Center, and it serves as an inspiration for millions of people around the world seeking a better way of life. Please join me in welcoming President and Mrs. Carter. Hi, President Carter. Haven't had a chance to see you yet. How are you?
Love you.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. Well, it's good to be with you all tonight. I guess I haven't heard the questions yet, but maybe this could be good. And I have two or three things to say. First, what we've been doing lately. Late in August, we went to Memphis and built houses for Habitat for a week. Our son Chip and his wife were with us. The news reporters told me that the heat index got up to 109 degrees while we were still trying to build houses outdoors. So we enjoyed the evenings. And also got a lot done during the daytime. And then I had my 3 months MRI scan this morning. It turned out to be okay. That was the second thing we did. And they can still see the scars on the brain, but they're small and they're not getting any bigger, so that's good. And then this past week, I was in San Francisco meeting with some people who might be of help to the Carter Center. We can help them as well. One of them is Lorreen Powell, who is the heir of Steve Jobs. So she owns a considerable portion of... wife and heir, yes, widow. And she owns a considerable portion of Apple Company. And then went to see Jeff Skoll, who started eBay. And he has a very nice foundation that already works with us. And then I had supper with Mr. Zuckerberg and his wife, Mark Zuckerberg and his wife, who is a very beautiful Chinese lady, and they have an 8-month-old child named Maxima, a little girl. So I enjoyed being with them. He started Facebook, yes, and he told me that.
So you probably know.
They've just passed 1.8 billion members of Facebook who have pages, and so they're doing quite well. The only limitation, he said, is the fact that they don't have satellite coverage on some parts of the world. And as you may know, the space vehicle that blew up last week had one of his vehicles on it that was going to provide coverage of a part of Africa. But anyway, these people are very wonderful, helpful to the Carter Center. And it wasn't an accident that I went out to see them all in one afternoon. Most of them have pledged to give away to charity 99% of all they own, which in the case of somebody like Steve Jobs would only leave about $500 million a year to live on, so you can see the enormity of it. But they are very nice people, and that's one of the characteristics of our country that makes me especially proud. No other country on the world has as much of a commitment to having very wealthy people give through foundations large amounts of money. Bill Gates was the one that set the goal for that. And while I was out there, we got a notice that the Gates Foundation had pledged another $15 million to our guinea worm program. So these are very wonderful things. Speaking of Mark Zuckerberg, he was very interested in our program in Syria. We have at the Carter Center, I'd say the most active and maybe the most helpful non-governmental organization dealing with the Syrian problem that's now been going on about almost 5 years. As you may or may not know, we've developed a system using Facebook to a great degree, but also Twitter and other social media, transmissions out of Syria to pinpoint the location of the senders. And if you on Facebook or Twitter or sending blogs, of course, the one thing you want to do is to identify yourself, unless it's encrypted or something like that. So the Carter Center takes those transmissions out of Syria, and by very complicated means, working with other people, we can identify where that particular person is located in Syria. So that gives us a chance, an opportunity, with about 100 a day of transmissions to pinpoint where the different factions are located in Syria. So we are the only ones that provide that mapping service to the United States government and to the United Nations and to the Soviet, to the Russians and to Economist Magazine and New York Times to show them constantly updated a map of where the different factions are in Syria. So if around Aleppo, one of the factions gives up or yields and another one takes over, we know very quickly who it is and what it is. So the United Nations has asked the Carter Center to be kind of the repository of all of their current information about the ceasefire and so forth dealing with Syria. This is something that's not very well known, but the New York Times and Economist always gives us credit when they do publish a map of Syria. Yeah, Google helps us a lot, and a company named Palantir helps us as well. We don't have the capability of analyzing constantly all of those social messages that come in, so we have a lot of help to do that. And Google helped us at the beginning to pinpoint exactly where in Syria each transmission comes from. It's a very interesting process, and I met with a young man who was an intern here a few years ago who developed this system. His name is McNabow, and I met with him this afternoon and his staff. Near her. So that's one of the things that we're working on in Syria.
And he was an intern. He came to the Carter Center.
That's good. Yeah. He was still an intern when Rosa said that. I just told him he was an intern.
I didn't know you told him.
And we also try to help with the ceasefire process. The Carter Center has constantly been dealing for the last 5 years with the Syrian government, with Bashar al-Assad and his government, as well as the main opponents, to try to work out some transitional deals where perhaps for, say, an 18-month period, the leadership role of Assad will fade away and so forth. That still is up in the air. But we try to promote the ceasefire process. And I just looked at the news hour on a public broadcast a few minutes ago, and they said the ceasefire was holding almost completely in the area that is set. So that's good news for the present time. I've also just prepared an op-ed piece for the New York Times. I don't know if they'll publish it or not. Just pointing out how stopping the killing had to be the first process. And stopping the killing will be helpful to the government forces and also to the opposition forces, and maybe as a prelude to their dealing with the problem in the long term. So that's just one of the things we're doing concerning peace. Another one that comes to mind is in Colombia. As you may know, Colombia has been plagued with a war with a opposition group named FARC for more than 50 years now. And the Carter Center has been deeply involved in the process of negotiating a peace agreement. I'm not trying to take credit for it. We just helped when we asked to do so. But almost all of the negotiations have been taking place in Havana, Cuba. And we've been helping them, and so has the government of Norway and others. So they signed an agreement last month, as a matter of fact, between FARC and the government of Colombia. And they'll have a referendum, I think, the 2nd of October, to see if the people of Colombia will accept the deal that's been worked out, largely granting some role for the rebels in the future processes, political processes, and social processes of Colombia. You can see how difficult that will be for some of the people in Colombia to accept, because a lot of deaths have occurred and people have been kidnapped and so forth, and they've had charge of a drug operation in Colombia, and to forgive them and work out a deal so they might be progressive citizens in the future is not easy to maintain. We've also had a very active role in election processes the last few months. Jason Carter, my grandson and the chairman of our board of trustees, was in charge of a group that went over to Myanmar, formerly Burma. And there was a very successful election. The constitution still needs some changes to be made, but Aung San Suu Kyi is now the new political leader of Burma, or I'll say Myanmar, and she's trying to work out some improvements in the country over a long period of time. The Carter Center has always had, for the last 2 or 3 years, and still will maintain, a full-time office in Yangon, in Myanmar. I've been there 3 times trying to work this out in advance, but we're still very interested in that. And Marianne Peters, who introduced me, was stationed once in Burma when that was his name. So the Carter Center is deeply involved in that possible future progress toward freedom and democracy and more justifiable claim for human rights. We've also done elections recently in the Philippines. That was in May, and I was watching the same news program just a while ago, and the president of the Philippines, Astarte, who's quite a controversial figure. I know it might be shocking to Americans to hear the prospect of a controversial figure being the leader of our country. I hope, as a Democrat, I hope it didn't happen, but anyway. I noticed a wave of laughter when I say controversial figure, but he just called on all the American troops to leave the Philippines. And they've been there for a long time. They were pretty active in the Philippines when I was president and since then, but he just called on them to leave because of some altercations with the Muslim community in the Philippines. And he claims that they are precipitating violence among the Muslims against other Filipinos because American troops are there. So he said it doesn't help for the Muslim citizens of the Philippines, who make up a great number of them, to be seeing American troops and uniforms everywhere. So we stay, you can see, when I read the New York Times and Washington Post and other news media every day, I can always see how the Carter Center's fingers are indirectly, at least, involved in some of the historically important events. I had a visit recently from the head of the Organization of American States, who came down the plains to visit me in my home, And we have a group called Friends of the Democratic Charter in Latin America. And so the Carter Center tries to work with former prime ministers and presidents in Latin American area on some of the current problems. So he came down to ask me and the Carter Center over a period of time to help with several problem areas. I'll just mention three of them. One is Haiti, which has an election coming up in October. They've had a disaster in political life, as well as you know, hurricanes and then the horrible earthquake that it had 2 or 3 years ago. And we're hoping that they'll have an honest and fair election in October. Venezuela, which is kind of a basket case as far as economics is concerned, and also the political situation there. And the Carter Center has helped to conduct 4 elections in the Philippines in the past. We've offered to help them with the upcoming possible elections for municipal offices and that sort of thing, but they have not approved having any foreign observers come in to help them. And another other country is Nicaragua, which in which we've also had 4 elections that were very important to us. We were the main observers in those 4 elections. The first 3 elections, the Sandinistas lost, and the last 4th election we held, the Sandinistas won. And since then, they've established pretty much not a democracy, but a way to perpetuate themselves in office. And so we offered to help with the upcoming election in Nicaragua, and they announced, Daniel Ortega, the president, announced that they did not want any foreigners observing elections in Nicaragua. That's the same policy we have in the United States. I'm not kidding. When we try to bring in a few observers, say from China, to look at American elections or from other places, we have a very difficult time getting permission from them to visit any polling places. We have to find just one or two states in America that will let foreigners go in and see what the election is taking place. So that's not an uncommon thing to have happen. We are also exploring the possibility of having helping with the election in the Democratic Republic of Congo, and I doubt if that's going to take place. We don't know yet about that. It depends on whether the president tries to have what I consider to be an illegal opportunity for re-election. His term is expired, and it'll be unconstitutional, in my opinion, for him to run. If he does, my inclination is not to participate, but I'm not the sole boss in the Carter Center. We'll still have to make that decision. But for a long time, we have seen that the Congo, as well as countries like Guyana in South Africa, have their great natural resources stolen from them. The wealth of diamond mines and of coal mines and oil and so forth. And timber from their woodlands, which are very valuable. They have a corrupt government, and then the minister of mining or the minister of forestry will make a deal with a foreigner, say for $50,000 bribe, and then they come in and take millions, hundreds of millions of products out of the country without paying for it. And so the Carter Center's tried to help them now for 10 or 15 years to make public those contracts with foreign countries who are going into to Congo, for instance, to extract their minerals without adequate payment to the people. Concerning human rights, we've had very active last year. As you may know, about the last 3 or 4 years, our top priority has been to deal with the worst human rights violations on earth, in my opinion, and that is the abuse of women and girls. Not only in foreign countries, but also in this country. I won't go into any detail about that. But we've had very good success in dealing with the Muslim community in some countries, including the leadership of the Muslim community, even in countries like Egypt. And so they have helped us with that. And we have had a program back in the fall in Ghana where people from Senegal and Ghana and other places in West Africa have come together to work with the Carter Center on how to do away with some of the abuse of women and girls. we have we'll continue with that, of course. This last this June, just a few months ago, we changed the subject this time, just on a general end to violence. Violence has it's hard to quantify the degree of violence, but the commitment of the world to use violence to solve problems has increased dramatically since 9/11, as well as the use of firearms in our country and maybe some renovation of racial prejudice, and we've had a financial crash, and our country has pretty well abandoned its formal commitment to human rights. I wrote an op-ed piece in the New York Times not too long ago, and showed that out of the 30 paragraphs in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, the United States was violating 10 of the 30 paragraphs. And a lot of that is, I think, an overreaction to terrorism. And in that process, we've learned to distrust our neighbors much worse than we ever have before, certainly in my lifetime. And so we've had a lot of adverse consequences. And of course, the United States has been in the longest war that we've ever fought in history, as a result, indirectly or directly, of 9/11. So we're trying to deal with the consequences of ending violence. One of the things that we decided was to try to prevent the United States from spending $1 trillion, which, as you know, is $1,000 billion, or $1,000,000, whichever way you want to say it. It's a lot of money, just on upgrading our nuclear arsenal. And that's a decision that's now being made, and we came out publicly and sent a delegation to Washington to spread the word that the Carter Center and others, many others, are against the United States devoting that much money just to upgrade our nuclear arsenal. If they do, of course, the Russians and others who have nuclear weapons will have to upgrade there, so the United States can take a position on that, as the Carter Center has done to start with. Let's shift now to health care, and I'm not going to go into detail. We have 11 cases of guinea worm so far this year. We've been disappointed in finding in the last 2 or 3 years that guinea worm is transmitted through dogs. And in particular in the country of Chad, we have seen that where we thought we had completely eliminated guinea worm from Chad for about 10 years, it has come back, and we now have a few cases, 6 or 7 cases in human beings, but several hundred cases in dogs. And what happens is that this particular river goes up and then goes down in the dry season, and it leaves lakes where the water goes down, and in those lakes, the guinea worm eggs breed, and the people catch multiple fish out of that. It's one of our biggest harvest commitments. And when they clean the fish, they throw the entrails on the ground. The dogs eat the entrails, and they contract guinea worm, which is later has a potential of going back into human beings. So we're having to deal with that on a different basis. We're making progress on it, and we'll keep you informed about it in the future, but it's a fairly recent development. Another thing that we do is to treat people for blindness. We have two major diseases. One is trachoma, and the other one is onchocerciasis, or river blindness. And I won't go into detail about that because you've heard about it before. But I just noted that with trachoma, we have given 140 million treatments of people to prevent their going blind. And in river blindness, we've given 240 million treatments to keep people from going blind. That's a total, by the way, of 380 million just for our blindness diseases. And the population of the United States now is 324 million. So this is 60 million people more treated by the Carter Center just to prevent blindness than the total population of the United States. It's hard to imagine how many that is, but I think about it a lot, and I thought you might be casually interested in it. So that, by the way, we have a crash program in some countries like Ethiopia to do these treatments. And we have trained more than 30,000 people in Ethiopia to be health workers, either registered nurses or physician assistants or licensed practical nurses who are able to be midwives and so forth. And when we go in and have a crash program for 1 week or 5 days to treat people, this last time when Mary Ann had a chance to be there for the first time, In 5 days, we treated 9.3 million people. But it's with the help of more than 30,000 people that we have trained in the past to help the folks of Ethiopia.
We trained 30,000 women and 35,000 nurses.
And now I'll turn the program over to the real boss of the Carter Center, who can correct my mistakes and also tell you about mental health.
I thought we trained 30,000 women mostly, I suppose. But didn't we train 7,000? A little further, a little.
I gave the best figures I
Jimmy, you know you did. He doesn't admit he's wrong, but he is. Well, I've had a busy, really good 2 days. I have the Mental Health Journalism Fellows here, and it's so exciting to me. I think it's my favorite meeting of the whole year, because it's so good to walk in the room and see all of these people sitting around and then learning how to go out and having programs in their countries that go out and spread the word about mental health issues accurately and in depth, because we train them to do that. And they apply, some of you know, but and why don't my fellas stand up over here? Fellas, can you stand up? There they are. We have 16 with us this time. That's more than we usually have. Thank you. They apply for a fellowship. The fellowship is 1 year. And on a day like this, there's 2 days like this, we have 1 day with the outgoing fellows telling us what they have done. And then we had, like today we had, the incoming ones telling us what they're going to do. And it's really exciting. And we've expanded the program. In fact, we began 15 years ago, and I remember the date because the first group were from New Zealand. And we were on the way to Atlanta in the car when we got the word that the towers in New York had been struck. And that was 15 years ago. But that's easy to remember when we started this program. But now we have programs in South Africa, or New Zealand, South Africa, Romania, and Colombia in Colombia. And
I thought the first was in the United States.
We have, I said that. We expanded it 15 years ago.
Okay,
let me see what. Oh, but. My good news is that we have added two more country partners. And so this time we have fellas from the United Arab Emirates and from Qatar. I've always called it Qatar, but today I've learned they call it Qatar. So, and Jimmy said he can read in the New York Times and Washington Post and all things about what we're doing and what's going on. Well, I can read from my journalists, because we have had journalists from both of those papers, those newspapers. We have them from the best places. This time, for instance, we have one from New York Times, one from ESPN, one from Al Jazeera English, and we actually have an Olympic athlete from the UAE who is a weightlifter. Isn't that exciting?
And stand up.
Here? She's here. Mm-hmm. I don't know whether she wants me to point her out or not. Well, we have one other program that I want to tell you about. And that's in Northeast Georgia. We have a program. We've worked on adults, and my mental health program actually joined in a suit with the advocates against the state and what our state was doing in the facilities for mental health facilities for adults. We got a good settlement, and the state has really cooperated and moved most of the people who were in the the settlement says that every adult moved out of a facility has to have a place to stay in the community. And we've done that with most all of them. The only thing that we, the state's backward on, and I can understand that, I think everybody can, because they've got the developmentally ill mixed in with, I don't think it ought to be mixed in with mental health, because some of these people have been, some are mostly bedridden, they've been in institutions for many, many years. It's so hard to find places in the community for them. But the state is doing a good job working on that. But our mental health program now has begun working with children and adolescents. And we have a program in Northwest Georgia. It's 17 counties. I think it's the Northeast Georgia Systems of Care. And it's run by judges, which is so good because the judge orders somebody to do something, they have to do it. And our goal is to keep at-risk young people from having their first imprisonment. And we're so excited about it because it really looks promising. And I'm excited about that. Well, one thing that Jimmy didn't tell you about was that I think I listened pretty good, was our Carter Center weekend. We have a weekend every year. We skied for 14 years. We didn't learn. Jimmy learned to ski when he was 62. I was 59. But we skied, and then the place we went sold the only hotel to Club Med, and they went up on the prices so much we couldn't afford it. And so we've been moving to different places, and this year we went to Annapolis for a weekend, and that was really good. And we have about 300 people there, and they come and bring their families. It's just a really good meeting. And this one was the best one we ever had. I cannot believe it still, what happened that night. And another thing, because the auction was so good, you can tell every year, about the first 15 or 20 minutes, whether it's going to be a good auction or not, because you can tell who's there, who's going to bid high. Well, this one started off high. I mean, really high. And all night long, everybody bid high. We hope to make $1 million. The highest we've ever done was one.
It didn't bid high enough, but
it went high.
Okay.
This one, total, I mean, the best one before this one was $1.7 million. And this time we made $3.7 million. Can you believe it? And one woman paid $750,000,
right?
Yeah. For a painting that Jimmy did. Somebody was bidding against her all the time. And but I mean, but what happens is sometimes is that people who want to give some money what they want to give, they'll bid high to get something. And I guess that's what happened that night. But anyway, I don't care what it was. It was good. And also, we celebrated our 70th wedding anniversary. And it was really wonderful. They actually had the chef from the baker from the White House, who was there when we were there, came and baked the cake for us. And it was really sweet. Had a live band, and everybody had a good time. It was just a really wonderful evening. So Jimmy is sending put me a message saying we have to have questions and answers, so I'll quit.
Well, President and Mrs. Carter will take as many questions as we have time for tonight. I want to thank those who have submitted questions, some online, some via Twitter, and some in person from the audience. We can't get to them all, but we have tried to choose a handful that represent the many main topics of interest. The first one is for President Carter, and it says, "We did enjoy reading your 29 books." They got that right. "Are you currently writing a new one?"
Yes.
Would you care to elaborate, sir?
No, not yet.
Okay. All right. Okay.
Well, I have to make a living still.
Well, then we'll move to Mrs. Carter. This question starts out by saying, thank you for your work on mental health. Oftentimes, lawmakers say they cannot fund the mental health system because they don't have the money. How accurate do you think that sentiment is?
They could do it if they wanted to. They just don't have mental health as a priority, and it really upsets me because mental health affects the everyday lives of so many people in our country who could work if they had treatment, who could, and it would help the economy so much, and hopefully are on the way to convincing them, but I'm not sure. It takes so long for anything about mental health to be passed by Congress, anything that concerns mental health. I had in my Mental Health System Act, which was a bill I got passed when Jimmy was president, I had parity, I had incentives for people to go into the mental health profession, I had integration of services, things that we still haven't gotten all of the things that I had in my bill passed. The incoming president put it on a shelf and it never took effect. But so much of it was done anyway by the states, but still it's very difficult and takes a long time to move forward. Actually, we got the parity bill passed in 2008, and it was not implemented until, 2014? Mm-hmm. Anyway, and it's still not working right because it was not implemented for so long that the insurance companies just started doing what they assumed and what they made out that the bill did. So anyway, I get upset when I'm talking about it.
Thank you, Mrs. Carter. President Carter, this question comes from, or President and Mrs. Carter, actually. This question comes from an eighth grader who goes to Inman Middle School. The question is, how can young people like myself help stop racism?
Well, when I was that age, I was immersed in a system of total racial segregation. And I was influenced by the people around me, like this young man is now. And luckily, I lived in a community where our family was only white people there. And all my playmates and people that worked with me in the field were African Americans. And fortunately, my mother didn't believe in racial segregation. She was a registered nurse, and she nursed in the homes of our very poor African-American neighbors. As a matter of fact, in those days, she worked 20 hours a day for $6. That was what they were supposed to pay her when they could. And so she didn't get off work until 10 o'clock at night, and she had to go back to work at 2 o'clock in the morning. And she would take care of the family. That was what the registered nurses did. So I was lucky enough, when I was young, like this questioner, to see the wonderful side of our African-American neighbors and get to know them intimately. And so when I wrote a book about my young life, An Hour Before Daylight, I tried to express in the last chapter the five people who, in addition to my own parents, shaped my life. Of those five people who shaped my entire life, only two of them were white. The other three were African-Americans. And so my life has still been shaped, in my opinions, and so forth, by African Americans. So I would say that for any young person asking the same question is to get to know as many people of opposite races as you possibly can. And if they're in your classroom, make an effort to invite them to your house, and maybe their parents as well, and the same thing with going to their houses. This week we'll have a meeting here of called the New Baptist Covenant, which I helped to begin in several years ago in 2008. And its main subject, this will be day after tomorrow, will be to encourage white, predominantly white churches to reach across sometimes just one street to their African-American neighbors who share their faith and have joint programs, maybe with young people every year, or invite the opposite pastor to come in your church, or invite the choirs back and forth, things like that. So I think the main answer to the question would be to reach out to people who are not like you in a very positive way and get to know them intimately. And the more you know them, you'll see that they're just as good as you are and just as smart as you are and just as ambitious as you are, and their family values are just as good as yours. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Well, I tried to think of an answer, but I don't know. I think what I usually tell young people and children would be the same, that let people know that you care about them, and we'll have a better world. I think maybe the children hopefully will lead us to.
They already are.
And they already are. They go to school and they get to know them, and I think they hopefully are going to lead the way.
President Carter, what challenges do you foresee for Colombia as a nation in implementing the peace agreement, and what action do you recommend its citizens take at this point?
Well, as I said earlier, this is a very difficult decision for many Colombians to make, and two previous presidents, including the most recent former president, has come out adamantly against the peace agreement. So it's going to be a tough fight in which we'll be on the peace side to get a majority of the Colombians to approve the peace agreement. And President Santos, who's done the heroic work of negotiation, is now responsible for that plebiscite to be held honestly and fairly, and we'll be there to help with that. But it's a matter of the people in Colombia choosing peace instead of a recommencing of the long-standing war and revolution. We'll be just giving the advantages of peace and trying to understand what goes on there and making sure that's an honest and fair vote. So that'll take place very soon. As a matter of fact, I think it's scheduled for October the 2nd. Is anybody no different from that?
That's correct, sir.
October 2nd. So you see, it's just just a couple of weeks from now. In fact, it'll be the day after my birthday.
Oh, I wasn't going to ask this one right now, but there is a question here. The questioner wants to know, sir, how do you plan to celebrate your 92nd birthday on October 1st?
I'm going to stay home with my wife. And
okay.
As you may not gather from the night, we get along quite well when we're home. But I'd rather, whenever Rosa and I are off somewhere, like in San Francisco or wherever, and we have our main wish is to go back home to Plains, where the others waiting for us and where we can be together in solitude. And we have a lot of our children and grandchildren visit us there. So Plains has always been a haven for us, and to get back there, I think would be my hope. I was scheduled to go to Hong Kong on the first day of October to accept a very large award that's being made to me in the Carter Center, but I've asked my middle son to go and accept the award for us. It'll be 20 million Hong Kong dollars, which is a pretty good size award, and I'm grateful for it, but between going over there and getting the award and being at home with my wife, I decided to be at home with my wife.
We understand. Sir, I could not ignore all the questions about the most obvious topic. That would be the U.S. election. So here's one. If you were to moderate a debate between the two presidential candidates, already an interesting premise, what would be the most important question that you would ask and why?
Well, I saw what happened to Matt Lauer when he... We made this attempt a couple of weeks ago. I think the main thing is to reach out to the public, which most of them do, and get questions in advance that are quite probing and really tap the desire of average American citizen to know questions to be answered by the president. So I would do that and get a list of those, like you are sending sometimes now. on Twitter and so forth. But I think the main thing would be to see how closely, this is a very biased question of mine. I would see how each one of them feels about peace and human rights. And I would guess, the reason it's personal is when I became president and made my inaugural speech, that was my main subject. I promised that our country, if I was possible, a successful president, would stay at peace and that we would honor human rights. And it would be hard to imagine either one of the two candidates making that speech next January. But I think I'd like to know how they feel about overcoming the present dissensions and violence and abuse that's sometimes part of a United States policy, and what they would do to bring about peace and human rights. I think it would be an embarrassing question to them because they haven't talked about that during the campaign. It's mostly about how we'll stay at war and how much we'll discriminate against other people and things like that. But I don't think I can think of a better answer right now.
Thank you, sir. Mrs. Carter, the Carter Center champions mental health initiatives. What should be done to help the 20 veterans a day that the VA estimates are taking their own lives?
I wish I knew. We talk a lot about, at a mental health program, about suicide, and it's tragic what's happening. And I don't have an answer for it. I think the VA is doing better now than it was for a while. And hopefully, I think the Veterans Administration is trying harder now, but it's just a tragedy. And it's lack of services. And I wish I knew how to.
They could be treated for depression, right?
They could be treated for depression. They could be treated for anything, but they stand in line sometimes and don't go for help. If we could just lift the stigma so that veterans coming home would feel safe going to get help, that would do more than anything, I think, because so many don't try to get help because they don't want to admit they have problems. I think lifting the stigma would do so much for any kind of mental health program, because people don't go because they don't want to be associated with the illness, which is tragic, because today the overwhelming majority of people living with mental illness can lead good, fulfilling lives in their communities, and people don't know that. And so many people don't know that. I've worked on it for 45 years this year. Started when Jimmy was governor in 1971. And I worked on stigma for 45 years. And it's beginning to lift a little bit. And
I think one of the things that the government could do would be to clean up the bureaucracy that is the Veterans Administration, which is kind of a recent development. It hadn't always been that way. And secondly, I think the government could finance mental health treatment, not only in veterans' hospitals, but also let any veteran who can't get almost immediate care in a veterans' hospital, let them have the funds through the Veterans Administration to go to private psychiatrists or other treatment. So there's some practical things that can be done.
I have a program at the Rosalynn Carter Institute for Caregiving for veterans' families. We tried to help veterans, and veterans, as I said, won't come forward. And we had developed an evidence-based program for people dealing with Alzheimer's, and they don't come forward either. And so we began to go in their homes. And so we switched our program, and Lisa, who's head of that program, is here today. We began to go into the homes and talk to the families. We don't talk to the veteran, but it's much easier for the family to accept our help. And we have a telephonic program if anybody knows someone with dementia, that they need help with, you can call the Rosalynn Carter Institute at our local state university, Georgia Southwestern, and you can get help free of charge on the telephone. And it is a really good program, and it really does help people.
Thank you, Mrs. Carter. President Carter, what should my major be if I want to do the most good in the world?
I would say public health.
Yeah. And, who can argue with that?
And there again, I'm quite prejudiced. You know, I have my oldest son and his oldest son are both lawyers. I left out lawyers deliberately. I won't go into detail. And, not because of them, but I believe that anyone who wants to make a difference in the world as a major, if they chose this public health, it would be the best way to serve many people in a somewhat sacrificial way. You can still get a fairly good income from being that. We have some top-notch people in our Carter Center organization who are experts on public health, and I think that's the best I can think of. I wouldn't derogate a school teacher and so forth. I wouldn't knock anybody else, but that's my own personal choice. Rosalynn might have a different one.
No, I thought I'd like to. We have so much interaction with the Centers for Disease Control and people in public health, and I have always thought in another life, if I come back, I'll be a public health person.
Jason Baumgartner asks, how are you doing on your birding life list?
Well, we just recently passed 1,300 birds.
Wow.
So Rosa and I get to take a chance every time we go to a foreign country, in particular since we've got most of the birds around our area. We make arrangements ahead of time with the U.S. ambassador to find a bird specialist in that particular area. And so if we have our first meeting at, say, 8:30 or 9 o'clock in the morning, we have plenty of time to go out and look for birds from daybreak until 8 o'clock. So it's a good way to expand our bird list. So Rosa and I took that up in 1988, I think it was. That was the year we went up Mount Kilimanjaro, and when we came down, we went through several parks, and our driver happened to be an ornithologist, so we got turned away from animals and toward birds, and we've been there ever since. So I think 1,300, and maybe 5 or something like that.
It's a large number. President and Mrs. Carter, how does your faith relate to your commitment to the Carter Center and other organizations you've worked with since your presidency?
Well, I, being the wife of the president, I had I have had a good chance to be involved with a lot of charities. And I think that Jimmy talks about his faith. He teaches Sunday school. I've always been very quiet. I like for people to think that I'm doing good and living like I have faith in God. And I do. And I have had, as I said, I've had good chances to be of help. And I think growing up in Plains, Georgia, where everybody helped everybody else when they were growing up. Everybody went to church. I was brought up that way. And so it has sustained me through the good times and some of the bad times in my life.
You know, I think a practical way to correlate the moral and ethical standards of the great religions was attempted one time in human history. And that was shortly after the Second World War, when we formed the United Nations to maintain peace, and it has not been successful, as you know. But a few years later, with the help of Eleanor Roosevelt and others who went to San Francisco for this purpose, they, and also to France, they passed the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which is 30 very brief paragraphs, which I would urge you to look up on your internet, if you don't mind. It wouldn't take you very long. And just read it over. And that was a distillation of all the top moral and ethical values of the great religions of all of them. Christianity and Judaism and Islam and Hinduism and so forth. And so that was the finest expression of what people ought to do for each other and how governments ought to treat its people than has ever been written. And we have basically abandoned a major part of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights in the last 15 years. And that's a very great tragedy. There have been some international agreements made. As you know, the so-called Geneva Convention established the guidelines for the way people treat prisoners in war and that sort of thing. And the United States publicly disavowed the Geneva Convention. So when the United States lowers its standard on human rights, it has a deleterious, a bad effect on the rest of the world, because human rights abusers who are look at the Washington and see that we don't honor human rights, they say, well, I can get away with abusing my own people and with impunity. So I would say that if you want to be a good Catholic or Protestant or Muslim or Hindu or Jew or whatever, and honor your religion, the best way is to try to implement in your own life in a very practical, secular way the Universal Declaration of Human Rights.
Thank you, Mr. President. This will be the final question, and it's one we haven't touched on. With the release of the movie Snowden this weekend, what comments would you like to make about personal privacy versus constitutional protections? Or privacy and constitutional protections versus lack thereof?
I'm glad I don't have time.
What question would I, what answer would I like to give?
What can you tell us about, yes. What would you like to say?
I think if we make a mistake, it ought to be on the side of personal freedom. I don't like the idea of government intrusion into the private affairs of our own people. When I was president, we passed a law that prevented the government from making any intrusion into the private communications of American citizens. And we set up a board made up of distinguished judges. And before the Justice Department or any police official could get permission to listen to a private telephone conversation, for instance, or an email, which didn't exist then, they had to get permission from this judicial panel. And after 9/11, the president, President George W. Bush, and the Congress had the law that I passed modified to permit, in a very hazy way, the government to do this. So I just assume now that when I send an email, it's monitored by the government. And if I make a telephone call, I just assume that the government knows what I say. And I think that anybody in this audience has pretty much the same problem. If you want to stay private, you just almost have to talk person to person to somebody. So I think that we make a mistake by having government interfere in our personal communications too much. I can understand the arguments made on the other side, which are prevailing now in the Congress, and that is that we need to monitor, say, 2 billion telephone calls a year, because there might be some terrorists from overseas that are calling to talk about another act of terrorism. I can understand the opposite point of view, but I think that can still be controlled by the court that I set up originally. So let us have our own personal freedoms and let the government stay away from them. That's my answer.
What a great note on which to wrap this up.
That's it.
Thank you, President and Mrs. Carter, for taking the time to be with us this evening.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you, everybody.
you would all stay for just a second after President and Mrs. Carter leave.